There are so many types of e-bike motor to choose from, but it's crucial you get it right because it's going to have an important effect on the ride dynamic and the performance on the trail. So today we're going to talk about the different types of motor and which one you might want to choose. So what motor do you choose? Now Bosch, Shimano, Brose, Rocky Mountain, Panasonic, Yamaha all have their individual motors and they all have their certain characters. It's more than just power here that we're going to be talking about. What we also want to make clear from the start is we're talking pedal assist, not throttle assist. We're talking mountain bike, not motorbike. There are three main types of e-bike motor. The first one is hub mounted, so that can be mounted in the front hub or the rear hub, and that's where the drive comes from. The disadvantage of them is that they affect the suspension quite considerably, and they're found mostly on hardtails or shopping bikes. The second type of unit is a bolt-on system. Now, these are custom fit to a standard mountain bike. They tend to be a little bit heavier than a hub or a mid-drive unit, and also you need to carry the battery in a backpack. It's the kind of system that Martin Ashton used when he did his trip to Whistler last year. The third type of motor is a central or mid-drive unit. Now, the benefit of these motors is they're smaller and more compact, which allows the frame designers to make the geometry closer to a normal mountain bike. Today, we're going to be focusing our attention on these mid-drive units. It's also worth noting that they're restricted to 25 kilometers an hour, depending on the country. Okay, just before we get into the nitty-gritty of e-bike motors, I just want to point out that you shouldn't choose your e-bike based on the motor in the same way as you wouldn't choose a normal bike based on the crank. Now, well, you have to bear in mind that geometry and sizing all do matter, and it's going to have an effect on the kind of agility and the stability of the bike. And we're going to cover that on a later date. Today, we're just focusing on the motors. Let's talk about weight of e-bike motors. Now, in general, they're about 3.5 kilos. This Bosch unit's 4, whereas, say, a Shimano is 2.8 kilos. Does weight matter? Well, not as much as such things as size or its location in the frame. You know, when we're talking size, a smaller motor allows more freedom for frame manufacturers to make bikes with good geometry. At the same time, it's pointless having a lightweight motor in the wrong part of the frame. So weight does matter, but do you know what? I wouldn't get hung up on it too much. And you know, it's more than likely that the weight of boat motors is going to come down significantly in the next few years. Torque levels. Now, we're not going to go into physics at this point. In general, they range from about 70 newton meters on a Shimano drive to about 90 newton meters on a Brose unit. Does torque matter? Well, yes, it does. It has an effect on how the power is delivered to the back wheel. A lot of people talk about level of support. Now, it's a very simple subject. It comes down to how easy or how hard it is to pedal your e-bike. Now, comes down to the level of assistance that that motor is giving you. Eco mode is going to give you about 50% assist, whereas turbo is going to give you about 300% assist. Now, it varies between brand to brand, but the principle is roughly the same. The bottom line is it's up to you to decide how you use that power. Let's talk about software and software updates for your e-bike. Now, my heart usually sinks when I see this on my phone, and that's all it is. It's the same as the updates on your phone. But on an e-bike, it's there to get the best performance out of your motor. And do you know what? It's as simple as downloading the app, connecting to your bike, and you can get all kinds of information. On some brands, it tells you when the motor needs servicing, but in general, it tells you everything about the kind of general health of your motor, a key part to e-bike maintenance. Okay, let's talk about displays. Now, that's your kind of little button on the handlebar, which is your connection between you and the motor. Now, it varies massively from brand to brand. Now, Specialized are quite minimalist. All you've got is a little button on the handlebar which controls the power output. However, you can also use it in conjunction with an app, which means you can find all the information when you get home. So, with a Specialized approach, you're concentrating more on the trail than on your statistics. On the opposite end of the spectrum, you've got Bosch, which can give you as much information as you'd ever want. You can still focus on the trail, but you can see what you're doing as you're going along. So when it comes to displays, ultimately, you can get the information in your ride, whichever way you choose. One really important subject that needs covering is resistance. What exactly happens when the motor stops assisting you pedaling, and after which point you're doing everything under your own steam? Now, this changes from motor to motor, but essentially on some systems, the drive decouples, meaning it's a resistance-free ride. You know, you can pedal like a normal mountain bike, really. And then on others, there's an element of drag in the system, so it's a little bit harder to kind of pedal. Okay, so what you're going to be asking me are, what are the ones that are resistance-free? Well, Brose, Rocky Mountain, and Specialized are particularly easy to go once you pass that speed limit. So that might be something to bear in mind when you're choosing your e-bike motor. Right, let's talk about e-bike motor care and maintenance. Now, these motors on the whole are pretty bulletproof. In fact, some are hermetically sealed, which means that no grime or dirt can get in the system. However, just like other things such as cars, motorcycles, hair dryers, drills, the same rules apply. They're not big mates with water, really. So I think when it comes to maintaining an e-bike motor, pressure washers are a no-no. It's more the kind of bucket and sponge approach. One tip you might want to use is get a track pump to force any moisture out of the system. If not that, maybe a kind of hairdryer or indeed a compressor and airline. It's only at those points that you really should be looking at taking the bike to a dealer to get it sorted out. Most problems are easy to resolve. On the whole, e-bike motors are pretty kind of waterproof units. But yeah, don't go wading through a river with a motor totally submerged. If you don't do that, you'll be all good. Okay, that's an overview then of the kind of general kind of topics surrounding e-bike motors. Now it's probably time now to kind of get into the real kind of nitty-gritty, the specifics of each e-bike motor. We're going to start off with the Shimano Steps E8000 system. First up, the modes that are available. Now, there's three modes on the Shimano Steps. You have Eco, Trail, and Boost. And the Boost will give you 300% level of assist. Not only that, you can actually customize each of those settings to suit your particular type of riding. Let's talk about the switches and displays on the Shimano system. It's very simple, there's two types. One is like a traditional mountain bike shifter, whereas the other one is really kind of more compact in this case of plus or minus. Now, the display on the Shimano unit is really neat. It's well protected behind the handlebar, and it shows the gear you're in, the power assist level, and also the battery range. Now, the really cool thing about the step system is you can customize each of the modes to suit your style of riding. It's a really nice feature. Now, you do that by way of an app called eTube, which you can download onto your phone. And in that way, you can customize all the kind of mode settings. You can check for firmware updates. You can pretty much go into whatever level of detail you want to. So yeah, eTube app is what you need to tune into. What are the characteristics then of the Shimano Step system? Well, overall, it's really natural to use this one. When you're pedaling the bike, irrespective of how much kind of cadence, kind of how much you're spinning the pedals, this motor will still support you. What's a really cool feature actually is that if you pedal in trail mode, it actually manages your output. So it's a little bit like kind of driving an automatic car in those respects. What I will say is that there is a big jump between trail and boost mode. You lose trail for kind of flat ground and transfers, but only the kind of boost for super steep technical climbs to winch your way out. Overall, the kind of motor is pretty small and compact at 2.8 kilos, so it means that a lot of the bikes with the Shimano motor have got really good geometry to them. Unlike maybe the Brose, Rocky Mountain, and Specialized, there is a little bit of drag once you can go past that level of support where you're doing everything under your own steam. But overall, it's a beautiful system to use. And what brands use it? Well, you have brands like Merida, Focus, BMC, Pivot, Ghost, Scott. So yeah, it's a really popular system overall. Let's move on to Specialized. Now that's that beauty behind me. Now in terms of the modes and support levels, there are three, Eco, Trail, and Turbo. Now, what's cool about this system is that through the Mission Control app, which you can download, you can adjust the motor current in each of those modes. So the range is actually infinite on this system. Now, all you've really got is a small kind of button on the handlebar, which is plus or minus power assist. The Specialized philosophy is you focus more on the trail than on a display. Having said that, if you need to, there is an integrated display on the down tube which shows kind of how much battery is left and what power assist you're in. There is actually an aftermarket Garmin unit available if you need to bolt something on, but like I mentioned earlier, there is Mission Control, which gives you every single level of detail you could ever want. Okay, what are the characteristics of this Specialized unit? It's protected, it's simple, it's natural, it's integrated, and it is super silent. So when it comes to riding it, it's got really variable power in one mode, and you tend to use trail quite a lot of the time because it'll give you a constant output. There's definitely a sweet spot in the cadence that the kind of you can spin the pedals at around 70 to 90 RPM. And also, when you go from trail to turbo, there's quite a big step. So again, like Shimano, you're only going to be using that for the super technical, super steep climbs. What's it like when you get past the speed limiter? Pretty good. It decouples really well. So when you reach that part where you have to kind of pedal under your own steam, it's actually quite easy to do this on the Specialized system. Who uses the system? Just Specialized. Okay, let's go straight in with the Bosch system. Now, Bosch have five motors, but this is going to be the Performance CX that we're going to be talking about. In terms of mode and support levels, it has four. It has Eco, Tour, eMTB, and Turbo. Now, the cool thing about Bosch is that eMTB mode manages the outputs for you. So it's pretty much, like I mentioned earlier, it's like driving an automatic car. It's really cool. Bosch have three different levels of switches and displays. They have Purion, Intuvia, and Neon. Now, it's the Purion which you see most of on e-mountain bikes, and it covers everything such as charge, speed, mode, range, trip, and total distance. Now, if you go to the kind of flagship, the Neon, it's insane. It's almost like a personal trainer. It's got everything in there. Okay, so what's it like riding the Bosch system? Well, pretty simple. It dishes out the power really progressively. And like I mentioned earlier, that eMTB mode, which is like riding an automatic or driving an automatic car. I think the key thing here is that philosophy. It's the focus on the trail rather than fiddling around with the buttons all the time. So overall, it's a really good system. If you do use it in turbo, you need to be really careful on hill climbs because there's a little bit of override which can push you out the edge of the corner. Also, maybe when you're kind of going past that level of assist where everything comes under your own steam, there's a little bit of kind of drag in the system, and also it's a little bit noisy. But overall, it's a pretty solid package, the Bosch system. Who use it? Do you like some high bike, Cube, Scott, Bergamont, Lapierre, KTM? You know, it's a really, really popular system. Now this is a Brose motor drive unit. In this instance, it's on a Fantic Integra 160, a brand from Northern Italy. Now, it's actually a Brose S, which is a development of the old Brose T. The key features on this are it's lighter, there's less moving parts, it's lighter, and quite like the Specialized drive unit, it's super, super quiet. What's worth noting about Brose is that for every second car that's manufactured in the world, there will be a Brose motor in that car, whether it be windscreen wipers, seat, steering wheel, mirrors, anything. It's a big, big motor brand. Let's talk about modes and controls and battery. In terms of modes, on this Fantic, there's three modes, whereas actually Brose on some other manufacturers, they're up to four. In terms of apps, there's nothing for the Fantic just yet, but here it's only weeks away. Now, another key characteristic of the Brose motor is that when you pedal beyond the 25 kilometers an hour restriction, there's no drag in this motor. It's still very, very easy to spin. Very smooth, very compact. It allows for good frame geometry. I mentioned earlier the kind of the Bosch eMTB mode, which is quite like an automatic setting on that bike. On the Brose, on the Fantic at least, you have to work through the numbers. You have to kind of go through the modes to get the most out of that motor. It's quite interesting. If you compare the Brose motor and head unit on this Fantic, you know, it's more of a kind of cycle computer giving you all the modes, whereas the Specialized approach is very much minimalist, so quite a difference in that respect.
Should we move on to Rocky Mountain? Yeah, I guess so.
Okay, Rocky Mountain is a really straightforward one. When it comes to the level of support and the modes, there's three. I don't think they do have a name. There's kind of easy, medium, or hard. In terms of display, there's no display. There's just a switch similar to the Specialized system, although it does have a kind of indicator of how much battery you've used. When it comes to apps with Rocky Mountain, there is one you can download on your smartphone, and that can manage everything from the levels of support in each of the modes to kind of maintaining your motor, and it's something a dealer can use to kind of diagnose any faults with the bike. So what are the characteristics of riding the Rocky Mountain PowerPlay? Well, you'll definitely find you'll spend most of your time riding in the middle trail mode on this bike because the top power mode is simply ludicrous. However, you don't need to worry too much about how much you're spinning the pedals, you know, what cadence you're in, because it'll support you no matter what. In fact, the kind of power delivery is really, really smooth in whatever mode you ride on this bike. A key part is the pickup. So because the engagement is so immediate, no matter how steep the terrain, if you stop and start, you can keep going really, really easily on the system. So there's no drag, there's no lag, and if you maintain it and lube it really well, it's super quiet too. And what brands use the system? Just Rocky Mountain. Okay, let's talk Yamaha. Now, I did actually see Valentino Rossi on a Yamaha e-bike only a few days ago. Anyway, let's talk modes and support levels. The Yamaha has five support levels on this bike. It has Eco Plus, Eco, Standard, High, and Extra Power. Now, it's worth mentioning that on giant bikes, the system is called Sync Drive Pro, and it has 360% of support. When it comes to switches and displays for the Yamaha system, this varies from brand to brand. For example, what they use on the giant system is quite different from what they use on the high bike system. However, what it does give you is a whole range of information, which is really quite engaging to use while on the trail. There's an instant engagement with the Yamaha PWX, which means that on super tech climbs, no matter kind of if you drop down to low speeds, you can pick up again really quickly. So in that respect, it's kind of that's a definite kind of strength of the system. It works better on lower cadences. That means you're going to be spinning the pedals lower speeds. It kind of works really well. Whereas you spinning the pedals on higher speeds, it kind of tapers off a little bit. Overall, I think the philosophy with the PWX system is that you tend to use the mode switch quite a lot, in comparison to, say, the kind of Bosch eMTB mode, which is like a kind of, you're riding on autopilot pretty much. So that's quite a big difference. It decouples reasonably well, so it's kind of pretty easy to spin those cranks. In terms of noise, it's probably kind of on the moderate scale. Overall, you could argue it's a less common system than some of the others, but it's nevertheless used by giant and high bike. Thanks for watching this Fundamentals on e-bike motors. We're going to be doing a series actually on geometry and also batteries on e-bike systems. If you found this video useful, please give us a thumbs up, and any more e-bike content, click up here for e-bike versus enduro bike, and down here to check out Nico Vulio's Lapierre Overvolt. Please give us a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe. Thank you.